So guys, welcome back to the channel. My name's Tom, and in today's video I'm just going to quickly show you my setup that I'm running at the moment for anybody that's new to the channel. And then what we're going to do, we're going to get into a video where we're going to actually process an image that I've taken a load of lights of. I haven't done much videoing of me doing a night out because we've not had a great weather again. It's been super cloudy, and you know, the opportunities I have had to get out here has been sort of like, you know, slapdash, quickly get on it and start producing some light frames. So let's kind of look at the telescope, and I'm going to just go through my whole setup of what I do and then how I process my images. So let's get into this. Right guys, so my main telescope that I run is the Celestron C11 Edge HD. It's a beautiful telescope, works really well. So I'm going to spin you around now, and I'm just going to go through every part of the telescope with you just to explain what parts do what. It's just a couple of people have commented asking what the setup is, and this is just to help you guys understand what I'm using and what helps me produce, you know, great images. Right, let's spin you around. Okay, so to start off with, I run the CGX mount, which is by Celestron. So then I've also got my counterbalance weights. It goes up to my dew heater. So the dew heater is just to control the ambient temperature, make sure that I don't get any dew on my corrector plate. And then the big black thing that's here, what this does is, this is just a dew shield, plus it also helps with the light. So for instance, if my neighbour's got to turn a light on, what this will do is it will just cut that light out a little bit and just help with, you know, not flooding out an image. So moving on to the back of the telescope, we've got here, I'll spin this round a little bit. So on here we've got the Eagle 5S Plus, which is a computer. It just makes it a little bit easier. I can then remotely access everything from either in the house, in the front room, in the guest room, or I can just sit in the observatory and just go for it. But what I love about this computer is the little eye, which tells me how dark it is outside. I don't think it necessarily tells me the clarity, but it does tell me the darkness of the skies, which is really helpful. So if, say for instance, I was to run, so I ran the Elephant's Trunk Nebula, what that read was, I think it was like 20. So if I was to run the Elephant Nebula again, what I'd want to do is I'd want to get it as close to that dark spectrum as possible. So I would run that at 20. If it was 16, I probably wouldn't actually image the Elephant Trunks Nebula, because the darkness in the sky is not dark enough to get great detail. And then this is my StarSense auto guider, and what that does is that takes a photograph of the night sky, and then it tells my telescope where everything is in the night, and it registers where my telescope is and what have you. But this is also the auto guider, so this actually is my guide scope. So a lot of people, you'll see that they'll have their telescope and then they'll have another telescope on top of it with a camera in the back. Ultimately this is what this does. And then I've got my spotting scope just here. So if I just want to make sure that everything is actually aligned properly, I can always go back to this and just see where everything is. And then on the back of the telescope here, we've got the Celestron motor focuser. So it's not an auto focuser, it's just a motor focuser. But that just means that when I'm actually focusing, I don't have to come and touch the telescope at all. That's an absolute nightmare when you're sitting there trying to focus on anything. It can be an absolute disaster. So every time you touch the telescope, even if you feel like you're touching it very gently, your image will shake massively. And then if I spin the telescope round this way, inside you can see that I've got my dedicated astronomy camera, and I've also got the Hyperstar in there as well. So it took me quite a while to get to this position and having an observatory and being able to photograph anything that was decent, but I'm really happy with how it's all worked out. The telescope, I think I paid about £7,000 for. The Eagle 5S Plus, I think I paid something like £1,400 for. And then I paid my Do controller and Do heater, I think that was about £400 combined. And my camera was £2,200. Hyperstar, I think, was £1,800-1,800, so nearly £2,000. And my Star Sense Auto Guider was, I believe, £750. And then also the motor focuser on the back, I think that was about £150. Don't hold me to all of those prices, guys. I mean, it's near thereabouts, you know. The Do shield at the top, I think that was about £150, something like that. But this is my setup and it works really well for me. Because I'm in an observatory, I don't have to worry about polar aligning anything. What I do is when I need to set everything up, I just go back onto my last load point and I just slew over to a part of the sky and it takes an image with the Star Sense Auto Guider. And then once that's done, you're talking about a matter of, you know, 20 seconds, 30 seconds maybe. A lot of people have said, you know, some negative things about the Star Sense Auto Guider. I've had no issues with it at all. The only thing that I find a little bit frustrating is if I go onto live view, it will stop guiding for some reason. I'm not sure why that is. However, it's a great telescope. It's a beast of a telescope. But I get phenomenal images out of it. I am struggling a little bit with the Hyperstar. So I do love the Hyperstar because of how much light, you know, it goes down to an f1.9, whereas the telescope in its original form is an f10. So all that means is your f numbers are the amount of light that's kind of being able to be gathered through your telescope, through your camera quicker. So with the f10, a 5-minute exposure, is very slow. I think with the Hyperstar, I think it's like 25 times faster light gathering. So yeah, really happy with my setup. It works well. So look, that's the telescope setup that I have. I do have a couple of other telescopes. I've got one that's still in a box. I've got a camera that's still in a box that I haven't unboxed yet. I'm sort of saving that one because I'm waiting until I get my peers put into the garden. At the moment, I'll just show you. So my garden, I'm not sure if anybody sort of paid any attention to it, it's been pretty bad. So I had loads of trees and things in the garden. We cut all the trees down. So my boys are there with me again as always. But I've just watered the garden and I don't want them to come back out here again. So yeah, that's my observatory, how it looks when the roof's open. I've got my all-sky camera and my CCTV camera at the bottom, a security light. We've got a double socket at the bottom. So the garden was really bad when we moved into this house. It kind of just been left to do its own thing. But now we've cleared it, it's made a big difference. So here's the garden now. You can see the grass is just starting to come through. I was going to turf it, but I thought, no, you know what, let's just get 20 kilos of grass seed and we'll just go over it. I rotovated it, I've leveled it, I've rotovated it again, I've leveled it again, and it's still unlevel. But it's looking a lot better than what it was. I might even post a couple of pictures of what my garden was before when we moved here. To what it is now. For you to get a setup like this, it is expensive, but it's well worth it in the end. The same with the garden, you know, trying to clear the garden so that I can actually have my telescopes out here as well, which is my ultimate goal. Is I want to be able to have the telescopes, like the AM5, I'm going to run out here, and I'm probably going to put it in this position, so, you know, not terribly far away from the observatory, but it does mean I'll then be able to go south and west with that telescope. So I'm looking at marking out where the piers are going to be, which I think is going to work really well for us. Alright, so what we're going to do now, we're going to go and put some images onto a computer that I've got off of my external hard drive. Now with that external hard drive, what I do is I plug it in. I'll show you actually where I plug it into. So I've got a little tie here and I put my external hard drive through that and I just plug it in at the top here. And then what I do is when I access the telescope from my computer, so what I do is once I've plugged in my external hard drive, I then pick my target, I look at what I'm going to get, and then I'll rename a file in that folder and start saving my light frames in there. So yeah, let's get onto the computer now and we're going to go through the whole process. So I've got a load of probably crappy light frames in there, probably got some good ones, I've probably got some ones where some cloud has come over, but we're going to go and process those and see what our end image is going to be like. So what we're going to do is we're going to run it through Deep Sky Stacker, and then we're going to put it into Photoshop, and I'm going to show you how I get my images out of the data that I collected. All right, I'll see you in a second. Okay guys, so here we go. We're on the PC and I'm going to bring in my light frames. So if you're new to astrophotography, your light frames are the images of the night sky that you're going to be photographing, so the target image. And what I've got here, I'm not sure how many images I've got quite a few. You're going to need to go through these to try and get a good end result. So we're going to just open it up and I'm just going to bring all of this in a little bit, make it a little bit smaller so it fits in the screen. So when you see here and you've got a plane going through, really I won't worry about it too much. What happens most of the time is when it goes through Deep Sky Stacker, it'll recognize that and clip it out anyway. So on here you can see, if I'm honest, I don't even know what galaxy this was. This was just a random area in the night sky that I picked and I was like, right, I'll hit that. So that's how I managed to get this image. Like I say, I don't know what it is. So anyway, we're going to go through images and we're going to delete ones that I don't think are going to be good enough. So I believe this started off quite early on in the night. There you see the bit of cloud cover came over. That shows how bad the weather's been for us. So the cloud comes over, it destroys 2 minutes of a photograph taken. So I started off quite early on and you can see the difference between an earlier picture and, you know, once it had got through the night a little bit later, the sky had darkened up and it was a big difference. So we're not going to be overly fussy. We're going to keep the planes in because I've never kept the planes in really. I always take them out. But yeah, we're just going to quickly clip through all of these, which is quite a few to go through. And I would say this is a tedious part. It's not really that tedious. I mean, I quite enjoy it, the whole process of going through all of my images anyway. Okay guys, so there we go. We've gone through all of the images. Some of them I'm still not overly happy with. Now do is we're gonna now go into our Deep Sky Stacker. Now, when we go onto Deep Sky Stacker, the first thing we wanna do is open the picture files, which is our light frames. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna find where we put it, which I can't really remember. Here we go. We're going to highlight all of our light frames and we're going to put them into Deep Sky Stacker, and then we're going to check all and we're going to see, so we've got 82 frames. Actually, that's not a terrible amount of frames to run with.
And then what we're going to do is we're going to put our dark frames into it next. So I've already done my darks. So my darks are 120 seconds, 75 gain, same as my lights. But what I did was I put my cap back on at the end of the night and took photographs exactly the same as if I was doing my lights, but obviously we've not seen anything. And then I'm going to do my flat files. I'll show you what the flat files look like and the darks and the offset biases and stuff like that afterwards. Okay, so we'll add our bias frames. Okay, so we're going to check all now and we're going to register checked pictures. We're going to do advanced setting because what we want to do is we're going to compute the number of detected stars now. So that's just going to show us how many stars it's actually picking up. So if we was to accept that at 361 stars, it would take forever to run. So let's go at 26%. I like to get around 150 stars. Let's do 30% and register. Do you know what, 210 stars? That'll work fine. So we're going to do it at 30%. But if you lower it, it's going to detect more. If you raise it up, it's going to detect less. So 98% would only detect 24 stars that would line up with the light frame. So it would, how Deep Sky Stacker works is it's going to pick up one star, for instance. So this is going to pick up 24 stars and it's going to match those 24 stars to all of the pictures. Now if we was to lower it, it's going to compute all of the stars that we've got. So it's now found 1710 stars. It would take so long to do, so we won't do that, and there's just no need for it. So we'll compute that again, 210. We're going to okay it. So we've got 2 hours and 44 minutes of light frames, and then we're going to click okay. And what that's going to do is going to start running through all of that. I'll fast forward through it for you, and then we'll see the end result, and then we'll open it up into Photoshop and start processing the image. Alright guys, so what we've now got is it's processed the image, and usually you don't really see a lot of detail, but we have managed to get on here a little bit of detail on the actual main file, which is quite rare to see any sort of detail. Usually you just see a few stars and that's it. It's quite a dark image. Anyway, next thing that we're going to do, we're going to shut it down. Okay, so we don't need to save it because it's already saved into here, and here we go. This is our autosave, so we'll right click it and then we're going to open it up with Adobe Photoshop so that I can show you what we've got here. Okay, so we've stacked our images on Deep Sky Stacker. Now what we're going to do is we are going to first off go to image and mode. What we're going to do is we're going to change it to a 16-bit. We'll bring this over, and what we want to do is we're going to change it to exposure and gamma. Right, and then what we can do is, so we've got a histogram up here. It's important to have your histogram. We want to try and keep all of this nice and tidy and together if we can. Okay, so what I wanted to do is I'm going to do a couple of curves just to bring out a little bit of detail. So darker, lighter, and then you've got this, which is going to really expose the stars, but we kind of don't want to blow the stars out, so we never really kind of go too extreme with that. To start with, I'm going to do it a little bit aggressively. But that's just how I kind of work. I kind of want to do things a little bit quicker, if you like, especially for the video. Okay. So once I've done a curve like that, how I usually do it is I do Control Alt Shift N plus E. So let's just do levels. We're just going to change this quickly. So we're going to go on to red. We're going to bring that down 39, so you can see by the histogram kind of just, a lot of people are like, oh yeah, we're going to see what the black one is, and we're going to see what the light colours are, and we're going to make adjustments that way. I kind of just do it by eye, if I'm honest. There is a method that you can use. I'm not that fussed about using different methods. So at this point, I've changed my colours again, and I'm going to use Control, Shift and Alt at the same time. So I press all three down, and then I'm going to press N, and then I'm going to press E. Yeah, and it's going to create a new layer. And then we can go back on here if we want to and adjust it, or we can go back onto our layer that we've just made. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go back into curves, and we're going to bring up a little bit more of the light. So we can zoom in and we can start seeing that we've got some detail there. And then I'll do the same again, Control Shift Alt N plus E. You don't have to press, so I was a little bit confused when somebody showed me this. You don't have to press N and E at the same time. So you press Control Shift and Alt all at the same time. Then you press N and then you press E. You don't have to press N and E at the same time, all right? Just kind of wanted to go over that again. Okay, so I'm gonna do another curve. And actually, I'm going to drop that down a little bit. There we go. Control Shift Alt N plus E, create another layer. And we're going to go back onto our levels. And we're going to go onto red. We're just going to bring it over ever so slightly. Green, we're going to bring it over ever so slightly to there. You see on my histogram how I kind of try to keep all of them very similar, all in line with each other. That's how I found it best. We're going to create another layer again, and then we're going to do curves again. So this is just quickly. I mean, you can literally spend hours and hours. I have spent a long time on processing images, but I've also spent a short time on processing images. So I'll make that a little bit lighter there. I'm going to do the same again, and we're going to go into levels again. So I like to, every time I do a new layer, I like to, or every time I do a curve, I would then go in and I would adjust my my colours again. So you see here on the bottom, there's just a little line, and it's, that to me would indicate that's a bit of light. You know, that's some colour. I don't want to go into this section at all, so I'm going to keep it beyond that. And you see on my histogram up here, we've kept it all the same, although it is widening up quite a lot. But that's just because I'm doing it quite aggressively. This is just to give you the basics of what I think you need to do to generate a nice image. Okay, so from that, because I'm quite happy with how this is starting to look, I am going to merge all visible. So I'm merging everything together. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back onto my curves again, and I'm going to bring it down ever so slightly, but I'm going to bring out a bit of light, being careful not to blow my stars. So like, if you know, you can blow it big time. We want that detail, subtle, we also don't want to flood the image with light. And I do find when I'm taking images of galaxies, I don't find the hyperstars actually as good. I think the hyperstars are amazing with nebulae, nebulosity, gases and stuff like that. I think it's awesome. When it comes to these sort of images, I find that actually running the 2800mm focal length, I can get a lot closer. You don't necessarily get as much detail, but you know, it's, you know, if I took a photograph, this is how it would look straight away with the 2800 focal length. It would be a sort of around this size. Instead, you know, it looks quite small in the image. So we've got to this point. I would probably spend a little bit more time, but I'm not going to. What I'm going to do now is we're going to go on to select color range. Okay, and what we're going to do is we're going to take that part of the color without affecting too many stars, like that. And it's just going to get a little bit of this edging around here, and we're going to adjust that slightly. So we're going to then go back onto select, and we're going to go select and mask, and we're going to feather it. I'm quite gentle when it comes to feathering, and I don't tend to go aggressive with the feather. Okay, so it's feathered a couple of sections, but then what I'll do is, because it's highlighted those sections, I'll then go into, say, vibrance. Now, you don't want to go silly with your vibrance. You know, you want it to still look quite natural, but you're going to be bringing out a bit of the vibrant colours within the galaxy. Okay, so, and you're going to keep doing that. So the next bit is you're going to select it again, color range, and we're going to pick maybe this part of the color. So you see, if I was to go here and be more aggressive, we'll change some of the star colors, but we could address that afterwards if we needed to. So I'll just do that section. So this is kind of like a bluey grayish kind of color. But then we're going to go into select and modify again. We're going to feather it, a little bit of contrast, and okay. So it's going to feather this whole area. But what I'm going to do, I'm just going to carry on with the vibrance at the moment. So we're going to, now you see, it's bringing the vibrance up. Now, if you see just around these areas here, that's what is changing. But we don't want to go saturation, ridiculously high, vibrant, high. We're just trying to pull out a little bit of detail at a time, so that we don't make it look unrealistic. There is a part that's, I suppose, a little bit artistic about it. You're trying to pull some of these colours out, and you can decide on how you pull those colours out, really. Okay, so we're going to select again, we're going to go color range, and we're going to try and go here. There we go. So we're going to get the outside area now, and we're going to do again select and mask. Now I'm going to do a bit more of a feather on this one, so maybe 8 or 7, 10% contrast, and okay. So that's going to feather all of this out. So what we can do is we'll do vibrance again, and then I'll show you after that how you can adjust the actual color differences. Okay, there we go. So select again, color range, and like I say, you can just keep doing this if you really wanted to for a very long time. I'm going to okay that. So we're now highlighting all of these bits all around here. It has picked up a few of the stars, but we're going to go select to mask. Now we're only going to feather it slightly, and a little bit of contrast, because you can always keep going back to that. You can keep on adjusting little bits and pieces. So we're just going to do vibrance. You see how on the fingers of this, it's adjusting all the brightness of that. Now we don't want to go too much. Try to keep that natural. So it's +3 and +12. Control shift alt n plus e again. Now you can see that we're starting to actually get a galaxy. So what I'm going to now do is I'm going to merge visible, because I'm already happy with this. It's starting to look nice. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to now trim. So we're going to crop our image. just like that. Well, we might get a couple of bigger stars in it as well. So let's crop it there. We're going to press enter. Excuse me. Right. Now, I've got a really cool filter, if you like, and I'm going to show you what it does. So I brought this filter. It was cheap as chips. I think it was like £7 or something like that. Well, it might have been a bit more, I'm not sure. But it's Astro Flat Pro. Now, if we click onto that, you see here what it actually does to the image. So we can zoom in and we can adjust things like the smoothness. So you see where we've got this light colour. So I would say maybe there. So edge clean up, you see it's cleaning that edge. I'm just going to put that down to there for now. And noise reduction. Now, I'm not too worried about the noise reduction side of things because it's not too bad. And they see the difference in that image at this point. It's a huge difference. But then what we can do is we can then go back onto this and we can go curves. And we can adjust our curves again. So we can bring out a little bit more detail without trying to blow the stars. Control-Alt. Shift N plus E, and then we can go to levels. We can have a look at our red, green, and blue. We can zoom out, and we'll create another layer again. Then we're going to do the same again. So we're going to go color range, we're going to try to look at that colour there, that section. Again, we're going to go select, and we're going to go select and mask. So we're going to feather this bit. Now, I'm going to show you now, if we don't go to vibrance, so we've only highlighted a couple of sections on this. What we're going to now do is we're going to do colour balance. So this is quite, it's like a blue, red, purple galaxy. So what we want to do is we want to start bringing out some of the colours, and this is where your artistic side of things comes into play. Yeah, this is how you're going to create that unique visual of you know, what you've seen. Now, I quite like the purples, so for that one, I would keep that way. I'm going to create another layer, and we're going to do select color range. So you can see where it had our color range before. We now want to try and adjust the outer section. We're going to do the same again. So we're going to go select and mask. We're going to feather it, and a little bit of contrast, and OK. And then we're going to click onto this and go to color balance again. So we kind of want to bring a bit of blue out. Too much blue is there we go, like that. So it's very small amounts. I mean, we've kind of gone -7, -9, and then -3 on that side. So not actually a big difference, but you keep doing it and eventually, you know, you'll change it to what you think is, you know, right. So we're going to go on the outside again. I'm going to do select a mask, a big feather. Well, actually, we won't do a huge feather. Contrast, we don't want to do too much. Yeah, so another little area again. And we're going to go color balance. We're just going to bring some more blue into it, and a bit more purple into that. Okay, I'm going to merge visible, and I'm going to create another layer. Select color range. We're trying to get these outer outer edges. Yeah, like that. And select a mask, feather it, a little bit of contrast. Okay, you can just keep on playing around with this, you know. There's no harm in experimenting with it. If you've got to start again, you've got to start again. It doesn't matter. This is all about experience. It's about gaining that knowledge of what works with what. I mean, this is just the way that I work with stuff. You might want to work with it completely different, but like I say, this is for me. This is how I like to actually adjust my images. I find it works nice. Add a little bit of red, maybe a little bit more blue on that. Take a bit of pink out. Okay. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back onto levels again and just have a check. I can bring that in slightly. You can always bring this side of things in. If you want to bring out your reds, you want to bring your green in, you see? It changes your green. And your blues. Okay. So then if we was just to go to merge visible again, I could then sit there and I could go onto my filter. I mean, I've messed around with this again and again and again. We'll zoom in, have a little look, see how it's looking. We can adjust this and get it to what looks right. That, and then we'll do the same again. Select color range, outer edge, select a mask. I'm going to feather it slightly. So if you added your contrast, you'd see it was only going to highlight certain areas. We've got nice feather there. We're going to okay that. And then we're going to change the colour balance again. More blue. A little bit pink. Too much pink. That looks good to me. And then you see, you keep on adjusting it, you keep on playing around and messing around with these arms that are coming off of it. You'll eventually bring out more and more data. And that's ultimately what you want to do. So, I mean, I wouldn't necessarily play around with this much more than what I have. Because you've got to be careful, you don't want to bring out too much noise. However, what we can now do is we can go merge visible, and then we could go to filter, and then we could do add some star spikes as well, just to give it a little bit more of an interesting flair to it. So this one came with what I had previously as well, with the filters. So I got this one and the other one at the same time. So we're on advanced, secondary flare. I mean, we can add other bits and pieces to this. Intensity, so primary. I mean, you don't want to go that much, obviously, but. Length of these, the angle. So you could adjust the angle. I'd go something like that. Number of points. Some people have 3, some people have 4. I like 4 myself. Spike sharpness. I think it should be sharp. And I like my spike spread to be nowhere near extreme like theirs, a little bit of colour, hue in it, rainbow intensity, not overly fussed. But then what we can do is we can always add as well. So like this star that is down here, it's a big star, big fireball, and we're going to show. So we're going to click on it, and we're going to show that one. The same with down here, we're going to show that one. You've got to be careful not to overdo it. So at the moment, there's not really any at the top. So I'd put maybe one there and one there. And then let's just okay that. See how that looks. And you know what? I would class that as a successful image. It looks nice. You know, it was 80 odd images, so yeah, quite a lot of data. It was there nearly 3 hours or so. Yeah, I'm pretty happy with that as a quick processing. You know, it's taken 25 minutes to open up Photoshop to get a finished image like that, and that's just to show you how quickly you can do it. Personally, I'd like to take a little bit more time, and I sit there usually, have myself a cup of tea and a few biscuits, and just enjoy my time on the whole processing of images, which can take several hours, sometimes longer. But with this, I'll probably collect some more data at some point and add the data to it, and I might even take the hyperstar off as well and start producing some closer images. And guys, that is it. So once I've created that, I'll then go on to file and I'll save my image. So save as. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to save it into my YouTube season 1 episode 17, and we're just going to save that as I'll keep it as auto save actually, because that is going to be a Photoshop version. I'm going to okay that, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to export as. And then, so when I'm exporting it, what I can do is I can change the size of it. So I'm going to export it as that, and smaller file, 8-bit. Just so if I wanted to email it, I can email it at that point and export that. Auto save, and then I'm just going to do one low res. Okay, so I've saved that onto there, and then you could always save it as, you could go onto here and you could do a JPEG or PNG. Let's do a JPEG and auto save, and let's do number 2 and save, and there we go. Okay that. So it's just saving it, it takes a little bit of time. Now if I was to go over to my auto save, I can open, oh, don't want that. There we go. And that's a low res. I can just ping that over. But you can see there's a nice bit of detail in it. I've got some nice colours coming from it. Not a huge amount of noise. So for, it's now 28 minutes and 42 seconds. It's been quite a quick little tutorial on how I process my images. You don't necessarily have to do it my way. Experiment with it. It's Photoshop. You know, you're not going to break it. As long as you continue keeping your original footage, you know, and you don't actually oversave anything on that, you can just keep on playing around with it until you're happy with a result. I wouldn't say anyone's going to get it perfect every single time. There's still so many times I go into images and I'm like, it's just not right. So, yeah, mess around with it. have a little bit of a play. I mean, you can always go, I mean, to the point I started looking at a sort of going into filters, and then I would go on to sharpen and then do smart sharpen and having a look at what the best way of doing things in here and sort of messing around with it in that sense and reducing noise. Right, so let's click on that and see what that does. So, you know, experiment, like I say, just play around with it. If you're having issues with it, just press Control and Z. Alright, so guys, I hope you all enjoyed the video. I hope it was beneficial to some people. You got to have a little bit of a look at my setup, what I run. You got to have a look at how I use the Deep Sky Stacker, and then how I actually process my images on Photoshop. I'll share this image at the end of the video. And until next one, guys, take care of yourselves, and I'll see you soon.